we are continuing with the resistance of same advanced marine vehicles. The next category of that is catamarans. Catamarans, you know, it's well known, having two hulls. The same displacement is being split into being supported by two hulls. And advantage of that, performance features, you can see there's a large deck area. A vessel which needs a large deck area, there's an option. Less roll motion because of the two hulls kept apart. And pitch motions upward, bad. So pitching is a problem with the catamaran. So generally you need a pitch stabilizing fin for catamaran if you need a more stable platform. When it comes to resistance for catamarans, you know that increased wetted surface, because more the same displacement is now split into two hulls, and naturally the wetted surface is going to be more wetted surface, and the frictional resistance will be more, and hence it has been estimated or evaluated that it's having a low performance from resistance point when the Froude number is less than 0.35. So from the resistance point, it's going to be bad if it operates as a Froude number less, and may primarily contributed by higher wetter surface and higher frictional resistance. Then it is the same length if you consider that it's going to be slender, and you can there's a high slenderness ratio, that is breadth or length to breadth of the hull is going to be higher compared to a monohull, and hence more slender and less wave making resistance at higher speed. So that's an advantage. So the Froude number is high, then more than you say 0.35 or so, the major contribution to the total resistance is coming from wave making. And now you have two hulls which are slender in shape form and which produce a less wave making resistance, will have an advantage if you opt catamarans. Higher hull spacing, that is the distance between the two hulls S by L, then less interference, isn't it? The two hulls when they are moving, when they are side by side, two hulls are moving, these hulls generate waves, or there is a flow across the or along the hull, and this flow may interfere if the two hulls are close by. And if these two hulls are sufficiently apart, interference effect will be reduce. So that is the importance of having the spacing here. Higher S by L ratio, lesser will be the interference effect. Reduced hydrodynamic performance or reduced ratio of wetted breadth of the demihull to its length. So it's related to wetted breadth, that is underwater maximum breadth, to the its length. So the hydrodynamic performance will be reduced for if this ratio is less. At higher speeds, that is volume Froude number, if it is greater than 4.6, resistance is found to be less compared to the planing vessels of the displacement type of the same displacement, planing vessels of the same displacement. So if you consider planing vessels in catamaran, and if you consider the catamaran operates at this Froude number range, high speed, catamaran found to be have resistance is found to be less compared to the planing vessel which operates at that. So if you properly design and space it, then the resistance will be an advantage in even catamarans. You can see that this is a resistance, you can see RT by W, there is a displacement into 10^10, that is what is plotted here. And you can see this is for different S by L spacing, there is a demihull spacing. So if the spacing is less, interference effect will be more, then resistance will be more. If the spacing is more between the hulls, interference effect will be less, and naturally you see the green line here, the resistance is less. So that shows the effect of spacing of the demi hulls in catamaran on the total resistance of the vessel. So these are same thing, you can see it's a different things, different forms which reflect the effect of spacing on the total resistance. Now you consider round bilge catamaran series. It's a high speed semi displacement catamaran hull form. We have already discussed the semi displacement thing. Now it's instead of monohull, it's in the catamaran, two hulls. Range of speed, and Demihal parameters speed Froude number 0.221 considered. Demihal parameters, that is CB block coefficient 0.4, length to volume ratio or length to volume ratio or displacement ratio is given by this one. B by breadth to draft ratio given by this. LCB 6.4% aft of the midship. Then the spacing, you can see Demihal, this range. Okay, so these are the parameters which are considered here in the this series, where S is the separation of center lines of the Demihals, that is Demihal spacing. So Molland, based on his studies for these catamarans, he has put total resistance coefficient is equal to 1 plus phi k into sigma into CF plus tau into CW. So here you can see, normally what do you see, that is conventionally for monohull you put CT is equal to 1 plus K into CF plus ZW, isn't it, or CR. Here you are putting some extra parameters, tau, sigma, phi, what does it mean? So these are the interference effects. Phi, what is the interference on the form factor? Sigma, what is the interference effect on frictional resistance? Tau, what is the interference on the way making resistance due to the two hulls? These are the additional, you know, or the variations appearing here when compared with that of the monohull. CF, you can use ITTC formula. 1 plus K is already said form factor of Demihal in isolation, that is, consider Demihal alone, what is the form factor. Then phi is introduced to take account the pressure field around the hull, that is basically what is the interference effect. Then sigma takes account velocity augmentation between the Demihals. When you see there are two hulls moving, there is a constriction brought between the two hulls, that is the width, there is a constriction to the flow, that means flow velocity increases. So that is the what said velocity augmentation. When the flow passes through between the two hulls, the velocity increases due to the constriction of the flow region. So CW is a wave resistance coefficient for the Demihal in isolation. CW, you know, you consider the Demihal as a independent one, you find out what is the wave making resistance coefficient CW. Tau is the wave resistance interference. The wave created by one hull interferes with the wave created by another hull. So these waves may build up. When it builds up, naturally the resistance of the vessel increases. So this tau is the factor, interference factor, which take into account the interference effect due to the wave making. So Ronbilge catamaran, same what we have discussed, details of models, what they are considered, these are the different models, model parameters are given here, all the form coefficients given here, then wetter surface area, LCB position, everything shown here. So this is the, these are the, you know, parameters of the models they considered. So here you can see this expression, what we have seen CT, this expression for CT, it is, you know, rewritten in this form, 1 plus beta k into CF, that is you just expand this, you will get this CF plus tau into CW. So phi and sigma, this phi and sigma are combined to give beta, that is interference like beta, and for Demihal in isolation beta is equal to 1 and tau is equal to 1, isn't it? If you consider monohull, beta is equal to 1 and tau is equal to 1, that is the form. So now these two takes care of the interference effect. You can see the monohull, the form factor 1 plus k. 1 plus k for monohull, this is for different length to volume. You can see this is the form factor 1.35, 1.2. So corresponding for catamaran, if you consider, see this is going to be higher, 1.48, here is 1.35, here is 1.48, here is 1.21, 1.33. So the, which shows that the resistance, the frictional resistance has, or viscous resistance has gone up due to the interference effects between the Demihals. Same for the same vessel, now you use CTS, that is of the ship, is equal to CF, frictional resistance coefficient of the ship, plus tau R, that is, you see that, into CR minus beta K into CFM minus CFS, isn't it? This difference is taken. Actually, you are reducing this because the frictional resistance coefficient of model and frictional resistance coefficient of ship are different. So you have to take the difference when you predict it from model to ship. So where CR is the for the dummy hull and is given by, so CR is given by this expression. You can see that CR is equal to A into L by, you know these quantities, length of the catamaran is known, displacement is known. So you know A and N are, you can obtain from here, A and N for different Froude number are given here. So what you do is you want to, you can find out CR using this expression from and using this table. So CR is obtained here. You need tau R. Tau R is given, that is the sea resistance interference effect. Tau R is given by this expression, for which it is given for different dummy hull spacing to the length. And if you choose one, you get A and N. A and N are obtained from for corresponding Froude number. So for range of Froude number, you will get tau R. This tau R you put, and CR you have, you get this quantity here. CFM and CFS coming from IDDC formula. So you know, we can find out all these quantities and then CTS. Okay. So you know it's clear. The catamaran total resistance is obtained using this relation, where the frictional resistance coefficient of model and ship or the prototype are obtained using IDDC formula using the corresponding Reynolds number. And here you consider the residual resistance coefficient is given for dummy hull here, and the interference factor is coming from here. So you get everything. So you can find out what is CTS. Another form is, next type of vessel is a swath. Swath represents small water plane area twin hull vessels. Swath is a small water plane area twin hull vessels. So here the features of swath, I think you understand what is a swath, so I am not going to give a definition, sketch or figure for that. So here the swath vessel, the features, two fully submerged hulls connected to the deck. Maybe I'll, there is a diagram, maybe you can show here what is a swath. You can see this is a swath. So it is a small, it is a cylindrical hull. The water line may be somewhere here, when it floats may be somewhere here. These two are the struts, this is a strut and this is a strut, then it is connected to the main hull. Okay, this is a deck area. So this is the configuration of, this is one hull. So similarly you have other one on the other side, this is one hull and other side. So here water plane, the strut is, water line is at this position, the water plane is going to be thin. There is a small water plane area, twin hull, you have one hull here, one hull on the other side, twin hull ship, that is called a swath. So this swath stands for that, small water plane area twin hull vessels. So the, so what you have is two fully submerged hull. We have seen that two hulls submerged, which gives the buoyancy support to the deck structure. They are connected through thin struts. Struts are very, you know, streamlined shape, thin, very slender. Usually pitching motion of the vessel is reduced using fins. Pitching motion will be reduced using fins. Low motion response due to thin water plane area, because the water plane area is thin. You see that the motion is less, and it gives a very good stable platform for maybe for research activities and all that. Research vessels which collect samples from seabed and all that, they need a stable platform. So this type of vessel helps a lot in that respect. Then long pitch natural period and submerged hulls. So pitch natural period is long, so naturally pitch motion in actual sea may be less. Then sustained speed capability in waves, because the motions are less, the speed can be maintained. So actual for the monohull shapes, the problem is the other type of shapes, or including catamaran, the motions are high. That means the additional resistance due to the motions become more. But in this case, the motion is less, and hence the additional resistance will be less, and hence the vessel, the swath vessel, can retain its speed even in rough sea condition also. Larger wetter surface area, you have two cylindrical hulls, the wetter surface is going to be, it says nearly three times the monohull of the same displacement. So the surface area is huge, hence more frictional resistance, isn't it? So naturally you get more frictional resistance. low wave making resistance because the struts are at the water surface, which is more thin, very fine, and wave making become less because of the slender struts. Proper spacing of hulls and appropriate submergence of the hulls decide on the interference effects. That is, if you submerge the hulls sufficiently and they are kept apart sufficiently, then you have less interference effects. Pitch control surface induced drag. If you are providing control surfaces to reduce pitch action, then naturally you will have an appendage resistance due to that. Spray resistance of struts at higher speed. When it moves at higher speed, there will be a spray generated from the strut, which adds to marginally to the resistance of the vessel. So here you can see just types of a mono strut swath. That is, instead of two struts, what you have seen here, we are using two struts. So mono strut means this were joined together to have a single strut. So that is a mono strut. So you consider a vessel with a mono strut. Then you can see the resistance given here, resistance coefficient of the strut given separately. This is of the hull separately, and then the interference effects separately. So from which you will get the total resistance of the vessel for different Froude number. You can see that different Froude number. So you just add up, you get the resistance. This is just given for a typical, you know, representation of it. Then resistance coefficient, swath vessels with displacement up to 30,000 tons and speed 40 knots is another type where the variations are given. Total wave making resistance, strut hull interaction effect, then the hull alone, port starboard, this is starboard interference, strut. So these are the different, you know, components given there. Similarly, instead of mono, you are now using twin, what same as what you have seen. So this is a variation. You can see the variation of the resistance coefficient. Forward strut, twin strut means we have a forward strut and aft strut. So you can see the forward strut and aft strut, what is the resistance variation, and of the hulls. We just sum it up, you get the total resistance. And here the same thing, you can see that interference effects, what is shown here, interactions between strut and hull, the forward strut and hull, interaction between aft strut and hull, then forward strut and aft strut interaction. So here you get the interaction effects. So these interaction effects plus the independent effect, that give the total resistance. Residuary resistance of swath vessel, there is a wave making resistance. If you look, you can see that this is a tandem strut prediction. You can see interference between the forward and aft struts, two peaks forward. You can see that two peaks, one peak here, another peak here in the curve for two or strut, and difference between one and two strut vessels small at high speed. So here this is a single strut vessel and this is a twin strut vessel. Okay, and here twin strut you have such a variation, two peaks, so the variation is high at low speed, but here it's less with a single strut. But when it comes to at high speed, high Froude number, there remains more or less same. The effect is more or less same. The strut influence is less. So this is for a residual resistance coefficient for low and high speed tandem strut swath vessels. That is, two struts are used. You can see the low speed design. Model. It's a, there's a particular type which is designed for low speed, and there's a particular one which is designed for the high speed. You can see that the high speed design, the resistance becomes low at high speed, whereas this is designed for low speed. That is, at low speed resistance is less. If you take the same vessel at high speed, resistance increases. So you find that. But this is a low speed design. The design itself is different. So at low speed, resistance is good. Fine, it is designed for low speed, but if you operate at high speed, resistance increases. Whereas if you design a vessel with a high speed design, at low speed the resistance will be high, but at high speed resistance become less. So these are the some of the, you know, type of vessels which we have analyzed using CFD and also did some experiments. You can see that resistance in against the front. This is one of the configuration we did, swath with two hulls, I mean two struts, basically two struts and also two hulls. This is one hull and the other side you have two hull, one hull, and actually four struts, one and the other side you have two, I mean total four struts. You can see that you have got a hump here, and then it goes up, same as what you have seen before. You can see here is the two humps, isn't it? One hump here, and also the before one, you can see the two struts, one hump here, another hump. So that is the characteristic characteristics of the resistance curve for salt vessel. This is an analysis which has been carried out using a shift flow, and same thing analysis with the shift flow. Now another type what we consider here is another hull form. You can see the hull form is different compared to the previous one. You can see here this is the form, whereas in this case this is the form variation. You can see that, and what is the resistance due to that. Subsequently we consider another one called four hulls, one here, two hulls here, and another two hulls on the side. Four hulls is again the south. You can see the variation of resistance, right? It speaks up at some point, then it reduces. And similarly for another type, the form is different, same four hulls. So you get this another. So these are the studies which have been carried out by us. Did CFD studies and also experimental some configurations. So this is all about the resistance part of a salt vessel. Salt vessels are, you know, the configuration. Now you have an idea about the resistance, and you know that low speed frictional resistance is going to be high, because for the same displacement compared to a monohull, a salt will have 3 times the wetter surface area. That is a huge one, but it has got lot of advantages: more deck area, more stable platform, and thin struts produces less wave making resistance, which can run at higher speed, and even in wave condition the speed can be maintained. Next type of vessel is a hydrofoil crafts. Hydrofoil crafts, you know that work basically based on, there are foils, hydrofoils, which are submerged or below the vessel, and these hydrofoils, when it moves at a speed, generate lift and push the vessel up even above the water, and thus the resistance water, it become foil bound condition, and resistance is reduced drastically, and for the same power the vessel can operate at a much higher speed. So that is the advantage of hydrofoil crafts. So we have good two operating modes. One is hull bound, that is in the displacement mode, and the other one is foil bound, fully supported by the foil, the whole vessel is pushed up. So takeoff speed is main burner, speed of maximum drag in hull bound mode. So when it moves in the displacement mode or hull bound mode, the resistance increases with the speed and reaches a maximum, and at that speed the foils will be more active, foil will push it up. When the foils push the vessel up, naturally the contact with water is reduced and resistance comes down and speed increases. So that is called the cruise speed. So there is a one maximum point, that is at which the threshold speed, and cruise speed is normally double that. Resistance dips between hump speed and cruise speed, that is, it reaches a maximum and then it drops and then it picks up. You can see here the resistance gives, this is a maximum threshold point, then you see at higher speed resistance is coming down, the resistance is coming down at higher speed, then after speed it picks up because of the high velocity. Okay, here you can see the trim of the vessel, the hydrofoil. You can see this is a hydrofoil which comes, this is a foil here, these foils will generate lift, this is a horizontal direction foil or maybe V shaped, which will generate lift and push the vessel up. While it's moving, you can see with reference to speed, the trim of the vessel change. The initial speed it is almost parallel, no trim. When it gives started picking up, the trim increases. At the threshold point, you can see the maximum just before, you know, takeoff, it reaches high trim, and after takeoff the trim reduces, and in fully boiled one condition it becomes even. So the trim reduces. So this is a variation of trim with reference to speed. Here you can see the resistance. Various components are given. Total resistance is given by this blue line. Then you have hull resistance, that is the foil drag. Then the strut drag. So there are different, all components are given here, and finally this is the total resistance of that. And you can see the total resistance increases. It increases steeply, reaches a maximum, and this is the takeoff. From here it will take off, then that means Hall moves up, then resistance comes down, and then due to the higher speed and high wave making, it increases like this. So the foil should have good lift drag ratio. When you design the foil, it should have good lift component. The craft must be able to operate in a stable and controlled manner. Lifting surface forward and aft are required for longitudinal stability. The lifting at forward, you need to have a two pairs, one in the forward and the aft, otherwise there will be imbalance. So otherwise the trimming will be excess. So you can adjust the flap or the foil to adjust the lift and then the trim of the vessel. A tandem arrangement, the load is almost even between these foils, so you have to have a balancing between the foils. In an airplane or conventional configuration, more load is carried by the bow foil. The bow foil usually carries more. We will see that arrangement. In the canard configuration, you can see that configuration here. This is a conventional, you can see that the foil arrangements. This is a forward foil, this is aft foil, and this is a non-split type because this integral, and this is a split type. You can see two foils are given. And this is called, this is a conventional arrangement. This is another called canard arrangement. You have here a small one, here is a big one, and here it's integral one, here is a split one, and this is a tandem one. Here almost you have both almost same, and here both are split. So these are the type of, you know, foils. These foils are underwater, and you have, if you take a section here, it is going to be an aerofoil or hydrofoil shape. So that means it gives a lift in the plane normal to this, the vertical direction. So that is what is saying, this in the canard configuration, the second configuration, the aft foil may take more load. So here canard configuration, this will take more load because it is big here, whereas in this configuration this will take more load, that is here the more load is taken by the foil. The fore and aft lifting surfaces may be split type or reactive type or retractive type in shallow water. So you can see that it may be integral or it may be a split type. So these are the configurations normally adopted for the foil arrangements of a hydrofoil craft. So hydrofoil craft, this is a surface piercing, SPM is surface piercing foils. The speed achievable is about 25 to 45 knots, 45 knots is a very high speed. Takeoff speed comes about 0.4 to 0.5 times of this speed. The resistance of the vessel in foil bound mode or those due to foil, in its foil bound condition, the ship is above water, the vessel is above water, so the resistance is coming from foil, appendages, strut and all that, and also the above water portion you get the aerodynamic drag. Resistance less than 50% of an ordinary ship with the same weight. So resistance you will find that is 50%, less than 50% of the ordinary. Surface piercing foil system have inherent static and dynamic stability, so they are stable. All the hydrodynamic features of that, if it inclines to one side, automatically the side which goes down will get more lift, it will push it back, it generates a moment, so it is a inherent automatic stabilization. So it will have in pitch, roll, yaw and heave. In foil bound, the craft is automatically stabilized by area stabilization, that is what I said. Then a deviation from the equilibrium position, okay, this is what I said. Suppose the foil is there, if it inclines to one side, the foil on the inclined side, lower side, will be more submerged. More submergence leads to more lift force. That lift force generate a moment to put it back. So surface piercing hydrofoil craft may suffer from heaving instability, that is another problem related to that. So our concern is we are looking more into resistance and speed part. Speed of the such vessels usually 30 knots, we have seen that. Foils are two types, deeply submerged, that is deeply submerged means the foil is one chord length submergence, shallowly submerged is the half chord length is submerged. Vessels with deeply submerged foil system, no inherent stability because there is no variation when it heals. Stability achieved by movable foils and automatic control system, you have to have the moving you know, fins which can be controlled using control system to, you know, stabilize the platform, stabilize the vessel. Hydrofoil craft with shallow will be submerged, operate at speeds of 30 to 80 knots, predominantly in shallow and calm inland waterways. So that is about hydrophiles. So there is no specific, you know, data available as such in the literature to show that what is the, how you estimate that, but depends on purely on the design of the hydrophile crafts. You have to look into the details and then only you will be able to estimate the resistance of hydrophile crafts. Other category, we are looking into air cushion vehicles and surface effect ship. Both come under this almost the same class, same way of operation. Air cushion vehicles means it's our typical one is a hovercraft which has, which produces a aerostatic pressure between the hull and water surface. This aerostatic pressure that is created using heavy duty fans put vertically, and this aerostatic pressure pushes the hull up. Because of high pressure, the hull of the vessel will be taken out of water, pushed up, and now the vessel become not in contact with water, and hence the resistance reduces and it attains higher speed. And since its hull is not in contact with water, water propellers are not used, but air propellers are used in hovercrafts. So this is a air cushion vehicle. There is creating a cushion of air at high pressure which pushes the vessel above the water, and which leads to reduced resistance. So here the around the vessel you have a skirt, flexi skirt is used, and air is supplied by fans. That is what I said. So you have a skirt, you need to have a chamber to generate pressure. So around the vessel you have a thick rubber skirt, and that gives a chamber, air chamber, and insert pressure or create pressure inside the chamber which push the vessel up. So air propellers are used. As I said before, water propellers are not possible because it operates, it is coming above water, and this makes amphibious. It can work even on land. It comes to the beaches and, you know, it can move through beaches and also move through water. So we say it is amphibious. Speed is root number 0.8 to 1.5 typical, where L is the cushion length, cushion L by B. This is a L by B ratio of that cushion. Cushion pressure is 5000 Newton per meter square. Air cushion vehicles are used for fast ferries and also landing crafts, because landing crafts means it can land to the beach. So it has been used by, you know, US and other for Iraq war. They have used hovercraft which came from sea right into the beach. So they have vehicles or equipments on board which can be taken directly to land. You know, you don't need a port or anything for that. You just come to the beach and unload it. Air cushion vehicle resistance, very small wetter surface area because it is pushed up, low resistance. Wave making resistance of the cushion is also small because it's only the body, not in contact air. So that is wave making resistance also small. Surface effect ship, the difference is surface effect ship is having two hulls like a catamaran. So the only the ends are open. So what you do is you put, you know, screens or skirt at the ends, so it get a chamber. The sides are rigid hull, and the ends, open ends are, that is aft and forward, are covered with rubber skirts. So you get a chamber, then you generate pressure inside and then it moves forward with a reduced resistance and high speed. So that is a surface effect ship. So here it says rigid side hulls, catamaran, and flexible sails at the bow and stern of the vessel are provided. So you get a chamber, closed chamber. Propulsion, you can use water jet or maybe normal screw propellers. There is a cushion L by B, you can see is 2 to 8, and L by B for SES with L by B, the fruit number goes up to 2. This is a range. SES has less air leak because it is a rigid hull, so air leak is less, so you have better efficiency in the creation of aerostatic pressure inside, better longitudinal transverse stability. So because of the hulls, you have the transverse stability, it's a catamaran, transverse stability is much better. So use water propulsion system which is more efficient than air propulsion at speeds up to 120 knots. Surface effect ships going to 120, that is nearly 230 kilometers per hour. You can see the vehicle moving, water vehicle, marine vehicle. power and drag of this type of vessels, power of two aspects for lift generation to overcome need power, one for lift generation, that is to generate the pressure inside for lifting that, and other one is to overcome the forward motion, the drag, to attain the speed. So total drag of air cushion vehicle and surface of a craft, you have the aerodynamic drag because moving high speed and is airborne, plus hydrodynamic drag, you have both. Aerodynamic drag, you have the profile drag because of the shape, and momentum drag because the air cushion also is moving, there is a momentum change when its speed changes, so there is a momentum drag. So hydrodynamic drag, you have cushion wave making, when the cushion is moving, it the cushion air cushion makes wave, there is a drag due to that. The skirt which touches the water, it also makes a drag, or seal in the CS, so also make, then plus side hull drag of this air. So you have a small component coming from here, another component coming from here. So here what it says, aerodynamic momentum drag is explained here, drag due to the rate of change of momentum required for accelerating the cushion of air to the vehicle velocity. So these are the components of resistance. One is the air resistance or air drag, other one is the water resistance or hydrodynamic drag. Air drag got two components, there is a profile drag due to the profile and shape and due to the airflow. Other one is due to the air cushion movement, it is a momentum drag. Whereas hydrodynamic drag got wave making drag due to the cushion, then wave making coming from skirt, wave making and also frictional resistance coming from the skirt or seal drag, plus in case of SES, the side hull, the catamaran, that also contributes to that. So cushion wave making drag due to interaction between the cushion and water surface. You consider there is a high pressure chamber which is moving forward, so that means this cushion when it moves forward generates waves, but not much, so that contributes to the wave making component of the resistance. So you can see here air cushion vehicles and surface effect shape. Here what you see is the Froude number. Froude number is given by V by GA square root of A and square root of the whole thing. Okay, A is, I think, is a cushion area. Let me check. This is a cushion area. So if Froude number is based on the square root of the cushion area. So A is the cushion area. That is, you know, the length of the cushion and breadth. So you get the cushion area from there. Then here is the wave drag parameter given by this expression Rw by FL. What do you see? Rw and LL. You can see Rw by L. Again, Rw is the wave making resistance, FL is the cushion lift. So this is the ratio of that. So you get this ratio over here, and it is done for different L by B, that is the cushion length to breadth ratio. So you can see that this is the very low length and this is the high length. You can see that the variation of with respect to L by B, what is the resistance you can, or wave drag parameter here. So for the same displacement, cushion area and cushion pressure, if you consider same displacement, same cushion area and same cushion pressure, the craft with higher L by B has low wave making resistance. That is, if you consider that the craft with higher L by B is high here 8, so the wave making effect is less, wave making drag is less. So that is what you prefer, it will help you in the design. So except at very high velocity, the air cushion supports 80 to 95% of the SES weight. So only how much, 5 to 20% supports coming from the skirt and the side, you know, hull. Almost 80 to 95% of the weight is supported by air cushion. Air cushion vehicle skirt drag. You can see the skirt. So I'm not going to the details. You can see the figure here, this is a skirt wetting drag what is given here, and this is a skirt wave making drag. You can find from this these parameters the values here, it is plotted against P by L. P by L is I think pressure by length, H by L, H is the height of the air gap, that is the chamber height divided by length of the cushion. Drag components of air cushion vehicle. you can see that drag components, this is aerodynamic profile drag, this is the momentum drag, then this is the wave making drag, and this is the weighting drag, that is a friction load. So the total thing you put, you get the total drag, and you know the thrust, this is the self propulsion point. So the resistance and thrust matching. For the components of SES, you can surface effect shape, which follows the LBB is equal to 6. You can see the Froude number, and here is drag to weight ratio R by W. You can see that what is the wave making drag is very less. You can see the speed Froude number is very high, but see the wave making is less. Friction is more, maybe even friction also here. You can then see that aerodynamic drag coming here. You adding up, this is the residual total drag, and the difference between total drag and the frictional drag, you consider the residual drag. The drag components of SES of L by B is equal to 2. Surface L by B, that is cushion length to breadth. You can see this is a characteristic variation of different components, wave making, how it is varying, friction, and then you have the residual drag, the aerodynamic drag. So all put together, you get the resultant one, the red line here. That is the total drag to weight ratio for the surface effect ship having length to breadth of air cushion is equal to 2. Yeah, with that I think we have, these are different reference books, and what you have seen, you can see the list of references here, and with that we conclude the all the resistance part of the course. So what you have seen, if you recall, you start from the beginning, you can see that we started with the basic principles of resistance, components of resistance, physics of the components, how to estimate the various components, what is a model test, how the prototype resistance is predicted from the model test, what is the extrapolation methods available, and how the, you know, the similarities from model to prototype are handled. That is, we had problem with the kinematical similarity because it is not satisfying the Reynolds number between ship and model. How to tackle that, where you use the frictional resistance coefficient from IDTC or similar expression, and use the Reynolds number for the respective case of the model and prototype. You apply the corrections for these variations, then you predict the total resistance after accounting for roughness corrections, seaway correction, that is the motion aspects. All this you find out the total resistance of that. Then we moved on to the standard you know, series and prediction methods put forward by different research groups for different types of vessels, where we considered normal conventional ships with monohulls, displacement type, and where we could you know, find out the resistance from the expressions or regression experiments or series starts of various research groups, and where one need to know the applicability range of this, and accordingly you can find out the resistance components and total resistance, and subsequently you can find out the power requirement if you have an understanding about the propulsive efficiency and all that. So once you get the powering estimate power of the vessel, then you will, after considering all the you know, losses, transmission losses and derating allowance and all that, you can arrive at the engine power requirement, which will go as an input into the design of the ship further, because once you know the engine, the weight of the engine is more clear now, then performance of the engine is more, then you may have to design a propeller based on the engine, that is, which is optimum from the engine point, then you get the total weight and everything, which will add to the fine tuning of the ship design. Subsequently also we have seen other aspects regarding the advanced marine vehicles. Advanced marine vehicles, we have seen the different types including planing crafts, multi-hull vessels like catamarans, swath ships, then high performance vehicles like air cushion vehicles, hydrofoil crafts, surface effect ships and all that. So with this, with the available information, all these portions have been covered under this course and resistance part of it. The next part, what you will be having is a propulsion of that. So which you will see the various aspects of propulsion, other things which will be covered later. With that I conclude the course. Thank you.